Hello everyone. So today we have Vijay with us, one of the achievers from NMET exam. So he has scored 269 this year, which is quite, I would say, a pretty big score from NMET standard. So we are in talks with Vijay today. Hi Vijay, how are you?
I'm fine, sir. I'm doing good.
Great, great. First of all, congratulations for your score. Yeah. That's a very, very good score, 269. I mean, on getting some queries from students, sir. I have scored 235, 240. Would this be enough? Would that be enough? Even we are not able to answer. So if someone like 269 comes up to and says, I have scored 269. So obviously we'll say you are definitely going to be there. Not only that you'll get a call, I'm sure that you'll convert it as well. So I'll be happy to see you at NMIMS next year and hope to talk to you again once you pass out from that college.
Sure, sir. It will be my privilege to talk to you.
The best part, Vijay, is that your scores are also very, balanced. I saw that your score in quantitative ability, logical reasoning, verbal ability. So they are all somewhere of 85, 92, 92. These are the scores, right?
Yes, I got 85 in quants and 92 in each of LR and your language section.
Very balanced score. So basically, no doubt about the sectional cutoffs as well. So you checked all the boxes, correct?
Yes.
That's great. So let's start with the beginning, Vijay. So, when did you think of doing MBA? I mean, what is your academic background? At what stage you thought of it?
I basically come from an engineering background. So I graduated this year only in 2020. So I basically am from VIT Vellore Institute of Technology.
Okay, great.
So I was placed as an intern in PricewaterhouseCoopers this January.
Okay.
And then when suddenly lockdown began, I thought of doing something extra. So from my college days only, I had some motivation of doing an MBA because I like that management field stuff. Okay. I had certain electives then also. So initially I was thinking that I will have a prior 2 years of work experience and I'll then go about for an MBA. Mm-hmm. But suddenly, untimely lockdown happened, COVID happened. So I thought that this is the time that I can get to prepare. And if not, I can at least give a shot of this year trying to do an MBA. And if at all, if I don't get a chance and if my scores are not good, at least I have the experience of giving exam like CAT, because most of the people give twice or thrice to clear CAT and get to a good college.
Right.
So I thought that I'll at least give the exam, and if I'm not able to clear, anyways, I can give it next year, because anyways, I want to have a work experience and I have my job in my hand.
Right.
So it's like a balanced thing. If I don't get it, I'll continue with my job. And if I get it, if I get a decent satisfactory college, I'll join it this year only, if it's possible.
Lockdown proved to be a blessing in disguise for you, that because of lockdown, you went for it and you cracked it.
Yes, because of lockdown, I went for it and I cracked it.
That's great. So, and how did you start your preparations then? I mean, the day you thought of doing it, so how did you start? Because obviously, by that time, you were a bit late, I would say. Because generally,
people start preparing from January. Yes.
So,
people have started preparing for next year on MBA also from this year, and courses are coming up live. With special discounts and all. So people start from January only, if they target good colleges. So coming from engineering background, I thought that my quants was quite good and LR was manageable, but I had only problems in English section. Mm-hmm. And this year CAT also proved a nightmare for my English section. I scored 98.7 percentile in CAT, but only 65 percentile in BRC. That's why I couldn't convert. I know that I'll not be getting calls from any of the colleges.
The same story is there with me as well. I also appear for CAT every year, and this year verbal was 78 or 79 percentile. And I mean, when I appeared for the exam, I was not sure of whether I would get 20 percentile or 100. It can be anywhere in the range of that.
Yes. No, actually, this was I initially practiced mocks for 1 hour paper. So 1 hour paper was good for me. I initially attempted 2 or 3 RCs. Then I went for VA RC. But a 40 minute section proved to be a nightmare, because in the first 10 minutes, I had only one question mark. And I was entirely confused what to do. Then I thought that I need to at least attempt something to get a good score. Mm-hmm. So I made 17 attempts, and hopefully I only got 7 of them correct and most of them were wrong. And the wrong part were, sadly, the wrong part were all MCQs. It led to a negative marking.
So
after the exam, I was just praying that if my English cutoffs are good, I'm good to go to a good college. Because in quants and LRDI, I thought that was manageable. Mm-hmm. Slot 3 LRDI was tough. I solved 10 questions and I knew that the 10 questions were 100% correct. So I know that the score of 30 will fetch me around 99 percentile in LRDI, because the paper was too tough for slot 3.
Of course.
So after the exam, when I came out, I just prayed to God that if I at least I'm able to clear the sectional cutoff, I'll be good to go. Mm-hmm. But sadly, due to normalization, my actual score was 16 in BRC and it came down to 14.
Oh.
And it led to more. I don't know how people scored more in slot 3 in VARC. Maybe it was easy for people who prepared. I also prepared well, but it happens. What
maybe
can I
it
do?
Was easier than the other slots actually, but still difficult.
Yes, maybe it was easier. I felt tough, but it will work according to the majority of the people. So that's why.
Okay. So as you clearly said that quant and LR were your strength areas and verbal was not that good. So how did you work on your weakness? Because obviously that means it was a weakness on your part and this was the only thing that you had to work on.
Yes, so I started reading a little bit of novels. I completed Rich Dad Poor Dad and I would recommend everyone to read that novel. That's a very good novel. If you want to do a finance from MBA, it's a very good novel you can start with. Mm-hmm. I completed Rich Dad Poor Dad and then I started reading some storybooks and I used to solve RCs every day. Mm-hmm. But the catch here was that I started solving RCs every day from September, which I thought that I was very late. I should have started it from July only.
Mm-hmm.
That was late because I kept on preparing for maths and LRDI and I wanted to maximize my scores. But I forgot that in the guise of maximizing my scores, I was just deteriorating my verbal section. I would have practiced more, I would have cracked it.
This happens with many students actually, because whatever is the strong section, they keep practicing that because that gives a pleasure to you that okay, you are scoring good in those.
Yes.
Rather than working on the weak areas.
So if anyone who is listening to this video, I'll say that it will hurt more if you are not able to get a decent percentile, it won't hurt more. But if you get a decent percentile, if you aren't able to clear a sectional cutoff, it will hurt you quite more.
Absolutely.
Because it may happen that I will not score such a high percentile like 98.7 next year. It may happen that. Because maths and LRDI are my strong section, it doesn't mean that every time I'm going to score 99 plus in each of the sections. A bad day might prove to be any one of us. So it doesn't matter. So I'll recommend everyone that give equal priority to all the section. At least if you don't give equal priority, give at least 60% of your part to your weakness. Because you know that if you want to maximize your scores in your strong part, you will do that. You just practice it, but don't just take it to a further extent that you are just compensating with the weaker part. Don't do that because I'm suffering for it.
Exactly the point.
NMIMS is a good college. NMIMS is a good college. I know I'll be getting a call and I have high chances of convert. But I've always wanted to go to IIMABC or LKI. I always had a dream of going.
Mm-hmm.
But after I get a college, I'll decide that I'm still in a dilemma whether I should be CAT or not. I have decided of it yet, but once I convert and if I have the admission letter in mind, I'll decide what to do. Should I go to a college or should I again try for CAT?
Absolutely.
That I haven't decided yet.
We should decide it at that stage when we have the final letter in our hands rather than thinking of it beforehand.
Yes.
That what should I do, what should I not. That's the right way of doing it.
Yes.
Absolutely. So what
because even
did you do?
Even if,
go ahead.
Because if I am able to convert or if I am able to at least give an interview, I'll always have the experience of giving an interview. So it will help in my next year also if I am actually planning it that way.
Absolutely.
An experience in interview always helps.
Absolutely right. That's the point. I mean, the way you said that when I was appearing for the exam, so the point is not that I have to take admission. At least I'll have an experience of giving an exam. The same thing at the time of interview as well. I mean, once you go through these processes, whether it is the exam or interview or GD or something, every time it actually teaches you something which can be helpful for you in the future. So,
it will teach you.
Yeah, I always tell my students, so however small the college is, you feel that, I don't want to go to this college, this is much below my expectations, still go for the interview and GD, this will teach you something. If you have got the call, just go for it.
Yes.
What's wrong in music? It's absolutely right.
Because interview processes for any of the college, I think the questions will broadly remain same. You'll have an idea that how your interview went and what are the mistakes you do.
Exactly.
Yes. An interview from college like IIM Ahmedabad or an interview from college like, I'll not mention any of the from a college like XYZ, doesn't matter, but the interview process will broadly remain the same. Maybe the IIM ABC guys will grill you more, but you'll still have an experience of giving an interview in any of the colleges you get.
Right, because many times these professors from IIM ABC only, they become some director or some professor there in other IIMs, the smaller IIMs or the other colleges.
Yes.
So you might get the same person there. The person who was taking IIM Ahmedabad interviews last year might be taking your interview in some XYZ college, as you said. And that's a possibility. Yes. It's always good to have the practice, right? Absolutely right. So Vijay, if I talk about this strategy, preparation strategy, I mean, when the exam was near, as you said that in September, you started doing for verbal ability, RCs and all. So just before the exam, if I talk about, let's say 2 weeks before the exam, what exactly was the strategy at that time?
2 weeks before the exam, I just planned that there are 14 days for, I'm speaking specifically with respect to CAT now, then I'll come to NMAT. Mm-hmm. So 2 weeks before the exam, I just thought that there are 14 days. I'll give 3 mocks in those days and I'll just revise my quants formulas, a few LRDI sets in the mocks, which I found to be useful and I found shortcuts, and few VRC parajumbles and one or two RCs apart from the mocks. I just went about in that way.
Okay.
I just want to let you know that don't stress yourself before just when you are 2 weeks, the exam is 2 weeks ahead of you, because if you want to learn something new, you can't learn. Whatever you have learned the entire year, it will only work. If you want to learn a new concept 2 weeks before, it will not help you. You'll only mingle with all those concepts which you have learned so far. So right. In fact, I will apply this before a month. Not before a month will be too early, but at least 20 days before you should stop studying any new areas. You should only revise your formulas.
Only for revision, basically, that's what you are
saying. Yes, only revision, give 3 mocks, and the mocks which you gave previously, you might have bookmarked some questions that these are useful, or some short formulas. You might have solved the question, but you found a useful formula which might come handy in exams like CAT and NMAT, where there are time pressures. So it might happen. So you should bookmark those questions and you should revise those questions. Not take any extra stress during this exam. And a day before exam, I should suggest that you should not do anything. Just glance through the formulas if you have written in quant and just relax. Read one or two editorial newspapers every day. Continue that process and just relax before the exam.
Great. And did you write any mocks of NMAT as well?
I wrote 2 to 3, 4 mocks of NMAT, if I remember. And I never got more than 215 mocks. And in exam, I was able to score 270. Oh. 269 to be precise.
Okay, so if I talk about these mocks and these quizzes and daily, I mean, exercises and all. So how much do you think that these things actually help you apart from the other things that you were doing?
So mocks are, I think it's a journey towards CAT. A mock will surely help you. It's a journey. Whatever you will prepare, it may happen that when you're not under the time pressure, you are able to solve questions. But when you're under the time pressure, it may happen that a formula is not striking you. Mm-hmm. Or you know that question, you may solve it without a time pressure, but within the time pressure, you're not able to solve it.
Right.
So mock will just help you go sail through this. You will get to know the nature of the exam pattern and how it works. So a student should always appear for mocks, at least 20 to 25 mocks if you're preparing very seriously for CAT. And if you're started late, like myself in July, or maybe around May. And if you're started from January, you should try to attempt 35 or 40 mocks, because you have enough time from January till November. You have enough time. Because if you don't appear for mocks, you will think that I know this formula, I know this XYZ formula, what will happen? A question will come, I'll do it. But the questions are not direct in CAT and that and exams like NMAT also. The question seems direct, but under the time pressure, you may just miss those formulas and you may continue with the longer methods which you have learned. So in mocks, you will just know. And then the other part is that how to leave a question. Obviously, you can't solve what the 26 questions in QA which came. And I think only no one could solve 26. Only 1 or 2% of the people, like teachers like you and who are educators in top institute, they only can solve 75. They only can get 78 odd marks in quants this year, 26 questions. But for a student who are preparing well, you should know when to leave a question. And you should know your weak areas. Suppose that modern maths was not my strong area, because only certain questions of PNC I was able to do. But when I found a big question of PNC when lots of arrangements are required, I always used to skip that. Because I know I will waste my time and accuracy will be very low, because you need to take many care of the things, because multiply by 2, divide by 2 factorial, there are lots of things to be taken care in PNC. If you miss one of the cases, you will get your answer wrong, and the question setters are always there to put a trap in your answers. I've always found this in CAT. Options will be like 64, 32, 128. If you do any of the things wrong, you'll fall into a trap. They'll always set options very beautifully, especially in exams like CAT and ZAT.
Right, that's right.
The options are very beautifully set. So you should always have your target.
Three takeaways I take from your thing. The first is that mocks are very important. Second is that I want to tell all the students actually, and many students actually do not accept this fact that you have to leave questions, and leaving the questions is a part of your strategy. We also keep telling the students somehow they don't, they don't buy it or they don't want to take it. So it's a very, very important point. And actually, because you understood this thing and this helped you, I think, in the exams, that yes. you have to leave questions. If the question is lengthy, because every question is of equal marks. So if one question is giving you 3 marks, the other question, which is going to take 1/10 of the time of that question, that is also going to give you 3 marks. So why to do the lengthier one? That's a very, very important
point. I would like to share a story of my friend. So he was also in the slot 3 paper of CAT this year. Mm-hmm. So in the quant section, what he did was he was only able to visit 20 questions because he was stuck in all the questions. And actually the last 3 questions in slot 3 were quite easy. At least I found them to be quite easy. A student like me or you is good in quants. So he missed those questions. He was regretting it later when he asked me that those questions were really very easy. And when he saw his response sheet, he was literally crying that why couldn't I attempt? He was stuck in those time and time speed distance questions, which was too lengthy.
And this is where so that is the come handy, because if you have appeared for the mocks, so in mocks, if you have made those mistakes, you will understand that okay, I'm not going to make this mistake in the actual exam at least. This is where
that's how, because yes, if you give 30 odd mocks, you can develop your strategy. Because in quants, what I do actually, I start from mid of the part, because I think that from middle, if I start, I'll be able to visit all. I have this strategy in my mind. I think the questions which come later are always easy. I found this in almost 80% of my mocks. So I apply this strategy, whatever I get, that question tab, I always start from the mid of the part. And then I glance through all the questions. I always appear quants in 3 rounds. In first round, the questions which are sitters, which you know that you will be able to solve in within 1 minute.
Absolutely.
So in this year's CAT, I found 7 such questions in first round, which I was able to glance through in 13 minutes. I solved 7 such questions, which was sitters, and it will hardly take 1 minute. I'm talking about a student who is prepared quite well. And then you come for the second round, you should always mark those questions which you think that you'll appear in second round. Because if you don't mark your questions, you'll again keep on finding where are those questions, and you'll eventually get up losing 2 to 3 minutes.
Absolutely.
You shouldn't do that. Glance through a question. If you think that it could be solvable in the second round, mark it. And you can again come and solve it. So I was able to solve 5 or 6 questions in the second round. And then when there were 10 odd minutes left, I went to the harder geometry questions which needed certain formulas and all. So I was able to attempt 18 questions this year, and I got one wrong, one theta question wrong. I was able to score 51, which gave me 99.43 percentile in quants this year.
That's great. And it shows that because you had a proper strategy in place, and because obviously you have appeared for the mock, so you could make that strategy, and that actually worked for you. This is a very, very good learning for all our students, Vijay. And thank you very much for telling this to us. And if I move ahead now, ahead of the exam result, then NMET results came. So after that, is the NMIMS actually the college that you're looking for? You are planning to go there, or still, you're thinking about it? You have 2 thoughts about it.
So initially, when I started CAT, I always wanted to target the top 20 colleges. I made a list of it. I'll go to these top 20 colleges. Mm-hmm. And out of those top 20, I made the creamy top 5. Mm-hmm. And ABC is always there. So I kept it aside, because that's a holy trinity that's quite tough to get, but I kept it aside. I targeted XLRI, I targeted SPGEN, and I targeted IFT.
Mm-hmm.
Then I came to SIBM Pune, NMIMS Mumbai, and the rest of the IITs which we have.
Okay.
So I'm basically looking for all these colleges. So I know that I'll not be getting a call from any of the IIMs except IIM Rohtak, because they don't have sectional cutoffs. They consider overall 95 plus. I filled the form of IIM Rohtak, though I always want to give an interview. As I told, I'll just have an interview with them and take through the process how it takes. It costed me 2000 rupees. If anyone who don't want to go to IIM Rohtak and don't want to invest, it's your choice. I feel that 2000 rupees is worth of getting an experience of an interview. I just paid 2000 rupees for it.
Your ideas are very clear, and actually they are a good learning for all the preparing students actually. Because not many people are there who are so clear about their strategy and about their ideas. And these are actually those things which show that you have done a good hard work. You have done a good work on the things that actually what needs to be done to clear these calls. And you are going in the right direction. I'm sure that your future would be very bright, Vijay. I'm very, very sure about this.
Thanks, topic. I hope so. So now in NMIMS, I'm targeting it. I got the SNAP result. I got 98.3. I'm quite doubtful if I get SIBM Pune or not, because they consider sometimes 98.5 or 98 or all.
Mm-hmm.
Z results were not quite happy for me. I just scored 93 percentile.
Okay.
Again, the VRC section was, I scored a little less. I was only able to score 8 marks in VRC. That's what took me. and few of the questions in quants, so I did quite silly mistakes. I couldn't that the, there was a egg question, if you remember. I found the answer as 11, but I don't know, there was all 9s and 9s confusing there. I marked the answer as 9. A 9 was the option. I was regretting after the exam.
I got it wrong. I marked 20. I don't know what did I do. I just knew answer has to be a multiple of 9 plus 2. And I didn't look at 11. So I marked 20. Yes. 20 was also one of them. So I got it.
17 was, 17 was a trap there, because everyone will get that according to the equation x less than 17. But if but the number of x can't be in fraction.
Fraction.
So the answer was to be 11. Yes, because there are all 9s and 9s confusing, and option was 9. I don't know, after getting 11, I marked 9. So, like this, I got.
I mean, yes. Are part of the problem. So, this happened.
And
so,
yesterday, I had my IFT exam also. I gave it.
How was it?
Hopefully, I see. It was good. Quant section, I was able to attempt 15 questions, and one of them is wrong. I know the circle one. And I forgot to take the. In the circle one, what I do. Yes, what I did was I took the diagonal of the square as the total. I there was a, some area left behind that smaller circle which was to be considered. I didn't took it. I took the diameter of the bigger circle and the two smaller circles equal to the diagonal of the square. Oh. And there was again a trap option 3 minus 2 root 2. If you do this, you'll get a 3 minus 2 root 2. 4 pi plus 3 minus 2 root 2. Answer was 6 pi. I looked at your solutions. So one question is wrong and all the rest of 14 are correct, I guess. In LRDI was a huge shocker, because DI sets were so irritating and the interface was so poor, I can't tell you. It was so pathetic interface. So I just attempted 2 questions in DI and I targeted 10 questions in LR. Uh-huh. I solved that 4. That was a sitter, I guess, if you have prepared that that arrangement one. I was able to solve in 2 or 4 minutes it took me. Questions were quite easy. It didn't require the entire table to be prepared. Mm-hmm. In fact, the last question was only of arrangement. The 3 questions were directly of the relation. They were asking how much consume, how much the value you are consuming.
That was an easy set.
Yes, and the four singlet questions were quite easy, and the calendar based LR set was easy. And in VRC I was able to attempt 24, and out of which 2 or 3, I think 4 or 5 will be wrong, because accuracy is generally low in VRC. So I think I'll be able to score around 120, and looking at the trends, I think the previous year the cutoff was 123, so I think it will be minus 10 at least, because the paper was tough. I don't think it will go beyond 112.
It will be around 100 and 105. So keeping this figure.
Taking to be the worst case, I don't think it will be beyond 110, because last year only it was 123 if you remove the 15 grace marks which were given, because that's nothing. They're just shifting the base from that to there. It doesn't at least make.
LRDI section was there. I doubt that many people would be able to attempt much there, because it was so irritating that a person start feeling that I'm not going to do anything here.
It's because the DI sets were quite calculative. That's a trend of IFT. I can't blame that. They are calculative, but the interface should have been good here.
I mean, the font was too big. I mean, there should have been an option to decrease the font so that I don't have to scroll down and scroll.
Yes.
The other side. So
at means they take around, I think, 1900 for the exam, and they can at least prepare a good interface for it, man. This is not done.
Problem with all of them. I mean, it's not about IFT only. There are.
I think examples. Last year was also the same case, and I think that they would have taken a lesson from it, and they would have not repeated this. But again, this year it was the same thing.
Arey Vijay, I've been appearing for this IFT for long now. I remember in one of the years, what did they do? They just picked this set from somewhere, probably DI set, and they just put it there. So this set was about some cars being sold somewhere in some of the cities, something like that. So what did they do? They changed cars with candies. Okay, but how insensitive these people are, that in the original data they changed cars with candies, but in the questions they forgot to do it. So the data was about candies and the questions were on cars. So we figured out that okay, they are probably trying to do something like this. So they generally
so
do.
Basically you would have got grace marks. I think the question would have been incorrect.
Then they gave grace marks, that's okay. But a person who has spent time, so I mean
that's the problem, they don't understand.
The person who would have spent 10 minutes on it and the other guy who just left it, so now they both are at the equal footing because of that, so that's not correct.
And but what made the paper tough was that IFT I think it to be an easier exam than CAT and SAT. And if I look at the LR sets also, means they were easy, the arrangement set was easy, but I don't think IFT used to have such. But if you look at the previous year paper, they were completely sitters of LR. Right. But this year the LRs were still tricky. If I remove the 4 singlet questions, the set that games and tournaments was really time consuming. I knew that 1:64.
But actually, I think what made it look difficult was the interface. Otherwise, the sets were not difficult. If someone gives me the same paper on the paper format, probably I would be able to do most of the.
That would have been.
Okay.
So, and if you look at the quants part also. Yes, if you look at the quants part also, they were lengthy. Means they were not just one or two liners, except one or two questions, if I remember. They're not one or two liners. Right. It required time to solve.
Generally lengthy in IFT. Okay, Vijay, so if I talk about this again, so coming back to it, so how did GradeUp help you? Now, I just want to know this from you. How did GradeUp help you in the preparation?
GradeUp helped me a lot because I didn't take any flagship course from any of the thing, but I only bought mocks from CL, a test series mock. I didn't subscribe to any of the online classes. I always used to access every offline material which I could get.
Okay.
So in GradeUp, the maths classes done by you and sometimes by Pranav sir, the LRDI sections done by you, and sometimes VRC section done by Krishnendu, if I'm not wrong, I used to watch those.
Okay.
And I used to always take the shortcuts which you have done, and sometimes I would have always chatted with you in the live chat also during your ZAT preparation. Also, I came in your live streams and all. So GradeUp was basically just an offline platform, and it helped me a lot. All the platforms helped me, but in GradeUp I found certain things that they were unique, especially the quants part. The way of solving were very unique from your side. The previous year's CAT papers, ZAT papers, they were very unique kind of solving. I like those. It was the way you used to approach a question. I remember there was a ZAT question which you solved on onions and all. There were some pizzas to be done, and there were some permutation combination question on onions and pizzas.
Okay.
You just split it into two and you just solved it very beautifully. I was just confused with how many cases I have to make. You just took that, considered it to be a truth table. Either this can happen or this can happen. There will be 8 cases, and you just directly multiplied it. So there are a few of the questions which I like.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. And Vijay, any specific feature of GradeUp that you want to mention here? I mean, which helped you the most?
The specific feature of GradeUp is the QA part. I think the QA part, I mean, I was able to score such a high percentile. I'd recommend anyone watching this stream, please, at least if you don't buy an entire GradeUp thing, at least buy the QA and LRDI part. It will surely help you. The QA part is especially the teachers, faculties like you, Pranav sir, and they are all, you're quite ahead in QA. The way of solving means actually you don't solve a question. You actually take the time constraint into pressure so the student can solve maximum amount of questions. There are two things that anyone can solve a question in n number of ways. But to solve 16 questions in 40 minutes and to solve 12 questions in 40 minutes, those 4 questions can actually make a lot of difference, both in the QA percentile and in the overall percentile.
And actually, therefore, only we all appear for these exams, all the faculties at GradeUp. We keep appearing for these exams because
you can,
of course, we can understand that once we are appearing, and, for how important the time is there and all alternate solutions are actually needed for these.
Yes.
Therefore, we do that.
Because the point is that teachers like you can always tend to appear all the 26 questions, but you always think from a student's perspective and you try to maximize the way student can appear. Because the average student, if they are able to appear 15 to 16 questions in QA, it's quite good, if I say. It's very good.
That's what it
16
is
questions in 40 minutes, yes, in a paper like CAT, it's excellent, I think.
Right.
And you actually try to bring those strategies in front of us and help us to attempt to maximize our scores. And you always tell us, I remember you always in IFT also, when I saw your stream, you always, in the DI part, you always told me that which questions to attempt and which questions not to attempt. There are also certain questions in a set that we should attempt. Certain calculations required, certain not required. But this year, DI was so pathetic that I only attempted two of them.
This year,
so pathetic.
Two of the DI sets I started, then I saw that first two questions were easy. I did those. And then the next two questions I just left. So I feel that this is the right strategy of doing these papers. And obviously, therefore, only we can tell the students, but we have done it.
And also, many of the teachers also, they told me that if you're not good in DI and you're not so calculation good or time constraint is there, you always try to attempt LR because 50% will be LR, 50% will be DI. Mm-hmm. Attempt LR and clear the cutoff because LR and DI are now combined together. So that I also did the same thing with RC. I attempted all the 19 verbal ability questions and I only attempted 2 RCs out of which 3 questions in each RC.
Okay.
Because time constraint was there, only attempting singlet questions, I thought it will be a good idea.
Absolutely.
Because reading RC was also so pathetic. Font size was so small and scrolling up and down was so pathetic.
Absolutely.
And if the RC was also, length were also 1000 words, means it was so time consuming.
It becomes time consuming, absolutely. Okay, that's great, Vijay. Thank you very much for taking out this time and sharing your strategies and thoughts with all the students. And I'm sure that all the students listening to this conversation will definitely be benefited from it. And thank you again. And I wish you all the best for your future, I mean, wherever, in whichever college you go. I'm sure you are having a bright future, because the way you have made this strategy for the exam, you would have a good strategy for your life ahead as well. Thank you, Vijay.
Let's see how it works. I'll be grateful that if any one of you listening would get some help out of it and apply it in your own way. Don't try to copy anyone's strategy. It was just a suggestion from my side. You can just try to incorporate some ideas and at the end, always build your own strategy.
Right.
Never try to copy someone. Build your own strategies. You can get ideas of how this person worked and how this person worked, and you can just build in on your own strategy.
Exactly. It's not a formula.
That's how I like it.
Right.
It's not a formula. It's not a direct formula that you'd apply it and plug it. Try to think the rationale behind this formula and try to appear that how we came across this. You'll also get a definite way to it.
Right. Thank you, Vijay. Thank you very much for sharing all of this.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.